Hello and welcome friends, myself Dr. Smily Pruthi. In this video, I'm going to take this topic, epigenetics. So let's get started. As usual, I'll be starting with some basic points and then I'll be coming directly to the topic of epigenetics. So let's see some basic points. First thing is gene expression, which I have to explain. So first I'll be explaining about this word, that is gene expression. You know, genes have all the information for all the work which is done in the cells, but genes are not doing that work. That work is done by expression of gene. That gene has to express itself so that this work is done in the cell. How gene expresses itself? By forming mRNA and then by forming proteins. So in a mathematical equation, I can say gene expression is equal to transcription plus translation. Right? Transcription is formation of mRNA and translation is formation of proteins. Now tell me, what do you mean by regulation of gene expression? Means that all this expression of gene and formation of proteins, that is which gene is active, which gene is inhibited, in which cell this gene should be inhibited, in which cell this gene should be activated, all this thing is under control, that is regulated, right? So this is the meaning of this term. Regulation of gene expression. I'll be using these terms in my upcoming slides. And the basics of nucleosome. What is nucleosome? In a mathematical equation, I can say nucleosome is equal to DNA plus proteins. Which proteins are attached to DNA? That is histone proteins. Histone proteins are rich in which amino acid? They are rich in basic amino acids. They have positive charge on them. So we can say that histone proteins are positively charged. Now DNA has lots of phosphates on it. So DNA is negative charge. Direct question was also asked in one of the exam that what is a charge on DNA? Charges in biochemistry are very important. So charge on DNA is negative charge. Now we have negative charge on DNA, positive charge on proteins. So they are tightly bound with each other because of the opposite charges, and they make tight compact structures known as nucleosomes. Now in case of nucleosomes, when this DNA is bound with proteins, then this DNA is not free. We can say this DNA is bound to proteins, it is not free. So this gene is inactive. And if we want to activate the gene, then we can separate this DNA from the proteins so that now this DNA is free from the proteins, and now on this DNA, transcription and translation can occur and this gene will be activated now. So this is known as regulation of gene expression. By making the DNA bound to proteins or making the DNA free from proteins, we can lead to gene regulation, that is either we can activate or inhibit the gene. Now next is PTMs of histone. PTMs of histone means post-translational. It is not post-transcriptional, it is post-translational modifications of histones, and they lead to regulation of gene expression. By doing various modifications of the histones, we can make the gene active or inactive, and there are six various ways by which histones are modified. They are acetylation of histone, phosphorylation, methylation, ADP ribosylation, monoubiquitination, and sumoylation. These are the various ways by which histones can be modified. Now, how PTMs of histones can lead to gene inactivation? I'll give you one example with the help of acetylation and phosphorylation of histones. See, acetylation of histone means we are adding this acetyl group on histone which is having negative charge. Phosphorylation means we are adding this phosphate group on histones which is also having negative charge. So basically by doing acetylation and phosphorylation, we are giving negative charge on histone proteins. You know that normally histone proteins are positively charged, right? And DNA is negative charge. So earlier when DNA is negative, histones are positive, then that gene is inactive because that gene is bound to the proteins. But now histones and DNA are same charged, so they will repel each other and this will lead to gene activation. So I can say that acetylation and phosphorylation of histones lead to gene activation, and on the other hand, deacetylation and dephosphorylation of histones lead to gene inactivation. Now, understanding the term euchromatin and heterochromatin, euchromatin is loose DNA. So in this DNA, genes are active, but heterochromatin means the tightly packed DNA with proteins. So in this DNA, genes are inactive. So we can say that acetylation and phosphorylation of histones lead to increased euchromatin formation, that is they lead to gene activation. Now there is a term, CG islands or CG sites. What that means? By Human Genome Project, we know that there are many CG sites in our genome. What are CG sites? Look here. These are two strands of DNA. C present here, G present here. There's triple bonding between them. I'm not talking of this when I say CG sites. Look here now. These are two strands of DNA, C and G, together present on the same strand that is known as CG sites, and C, that is cytosine of CG site, is usually methylated, and this will lead to inactivation of that gene. In mammals, 70 to 80% of cytosine of CG site is methylated, means 70 to 80% of genes in mammals are inactivated. You know, we have so many genes, but most of our genes we don't require, and that's why they are methylated, that means inactivated. But if we require those genes in some condition, then we can make them activated by removing that methyl group. So you can see the structure of cytosine. Cytosine is having amino group here. This is one ring having amino group. We can add methyl group here at number fifth position. This is done with the help of enzyme DNA methyl transferases, short form DNMTs, and this methyl group is donated by SAM, that is S-adenosylmethionine, and this methyl group added, and this is known as 5-methyl cytosine. The majority of gene promoters, you know, promoter is a site upstream to the gene present, and this promoter can help in gene regulation. It can either activate or inactivate the gene. So these gene promoters are rich in CG sites. So what we can do with the help of the CG sites, we can regulate the gene expression by adding methyl group on the cytosine or removing the methyl group. So I'll give you one example here. For example, in non-hematopoietic cells, we do not require globin chain to be synthesized. So globin chain gene is methylated so that this gene is inactive in case of non-hematopoietic cells. But in case of hematopoietic cells, these genes are hypomethylated. Now coming to our actual topic, that is epigenetics, is actually information present in the genome which can alter the pattern of gene expression, but it is not mutation. Epigenetics, from the word epi, means above the genetics. Genetics refers to the codons present in the genes which are giving rise to amino acids and proteins. But this is some information present in the genes which is above genetics, which is above the codons. It is not change in DNA codons. It is actually some chemical change in the DNA or proteins. And this kind of information is transferred to the next generation. Unlike mutations, these changes are reversible. So the various epigenetic changes which can occur are, first is methylation of the cytosine of the CG site, that is occurring in DNA. In case of proteins, that is histones, PTMs of histones, most common are acetylation and deacetylation. And also changes in the higher order of chromosome structure can occur, that is euchromatin or heterochromatin formation. Now the best understood epigenetic change in DNA is DNA methylation on the cytosine of CG sites, and the enzyme involved is DNA methyl transferases, DNMTs. And the best understood epigenetic change in histones is histone acetylation and deacetylation. The enzymes involved are, first is HAT, histone acetyl transferase, which is involved in histone acetylation. Other is HDAC, histone deacetylases, involved in histone deacetylation. And this PTMs of histones mainly occur on the lysine residue on the proteins, and less commonly it can occur on arginine. You can see here lysine, arginine, they are basic amino acids having positive charge. And less common modification in histone is histone methylation, and the enzyme involved here is histone methyl transferases. Next is epigenetic changes can sometimes cause diseases. For example, some cases of cancer has been found because of the modification in epigenetic changes, like promoter hypermethylation of tumor suppressor genes occur. So what that means, that tumor suppressor genes promoter is hypermethylated, means inactivated, means tumor suppressor genes are inactivated, that means tumor suppressor proteins are not synthesized, and this will increase the chances of malignancy or cancer. Second is aging. Epigenetic changes also have role in aging. And third is Fragile X syndrome is also because of modification of epigenetic changes. Let's see the detail of Fragile X syndrome. There's a gene present on the long arm of X chromosome known as FMR1 gene. Full form is Fragile X mental retardation gene. This is a normal gene present which is required in body. So it will be transcribed and translated to form its protein, that is Fragile X mental retardation protein, FMRP protein. And this protein has a role in the normal development of the connections in the neurons during development. Now what happens in Fragile X syndrome, that there is expansion of CGG triplet in this gene, leading to gene silencing. And how it occurs, because of promoter site hypermethylation, so this gene silencing will not lead to the production of that FMRP protein, and therefore these patients will be having mental retardation, mutation known as fragile X mental retardation. Now see this X chromosome. This is normal X chromosome which is there in a normal person. But in case of fragile X syndrome, there is a fragile site present here in the X chromosome, in the long arm of X chromosome, because of CCG triplet repeats which occur. Some books write CCG and some books write CGG. So you can say both are correct. So in a normal person, these repeats are ranging from 5 to 50 repeats. And in a carrier patient, these will be 50 to 200 repeats. And if the repeats in some person are more than 200 here at this site, then this is an individual affected by fragile X syndrome. One very important point here is genetic anticipation. What happens that the number of repeats which are found in a normal person, or especially you will say the number of repeats found in a carrier patient, will increase from generation to generation until an affected individual is produced, and this process is known as genetic anticipation. So that's why the carrier of this disease is known as pre-mutation, because once it is a carrier person, then the repeats will be increasing from generation to generation, finally leading to mutation here. That's why carrier is known as pre-mutation. Now fragile X syndrome is one of the most common cause of inherited mental retardation, and the various characteristics found in these kind of patients are mild to moderate mental retardation. Retardation occurs, long and narrow faces occurs, large ears they have, and enlarged testicles, that is macroorchidism, occurs in these patients. So these were the diseases or abnormalities occurring because of epigenetic changes, but we also have use of these epigenetic changes. For example, they are having a role in regulation of gene expression, in defense mechanism also they have a role. And one more very important point is X chromosome inactivation is also because of epigenetic changes and also genomic imprinting. It is a very, very important topic. I'll be taking this topic in another video. So in this video, the last topic which I can take is X chromosome inactivation, or also known as facultative heterochromatin. You know, heterochromatin means the gene is transcriptionally inactive, and facultative means it is optional. That is, it can be activated again. For example, we do that facultative anaerobes are organisms which uses oxygen, but they can also survive in anaerobic conditions if those conditions are coming. So facultative means optional. So this chromatin is normally inactive, but it can also be activated again. And this may be packaged as euchromatin in other cells. For example, X chromosome inactivation in a female mammal, that is one X chromosome is packaged as facultative heterochromatin and it is silenced, while the other X chromosome is packaged as euchromatin and it is expressed. So here we can see the differences also between facultative and constitutive heterochromatin. Facultative is transcriptionally inactive, but it can be activated. But constitutive heterochromatin is always inactive, and the constitutive heterochromatin is repetitive structure present normally at the telomeric region or the centromeric region, and it provides a structural role. Now summarizing this topic, euchromatin means transcriptionally active, it is loose, but heterochromatin is tightly packed and condensed and it is transcriptionally inactive. Epigenetic changes are transferred to next generation and they are reversible. Acetylation and phosphorylation of histones lead to gene activation, and on the other hand, deacetylation and dephosphorylation leads to gene activation. X chromosome inactivation in females is correlated with extensive CG island methylation on one chromosome, which is condensed, inactivated, and bar body formation occurs. Alteration in gene and CG island methylation patterns are also seen in aging and in cancer. This is it with this topic. Thanks for watching. Best wishes to you.